attention.
The sound is really quiet on the screen back there.
Well, it was really loud. So
oh, okay. All right. So
if you get your mom's to press button.
We'll try this again. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Morning. What a beautiful day to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, this is going to be an exciting day, not only here at First Baptist, but also, what is the name of the church that Tiffany has gone to? I know it's in Gig Harbor.
Peninsula.
Bible Church. All right. Well, we need to just lift up Tiffany in prayer today. This is her first day as senior pastor of Peninsula Bible Church in Gig Harbor. So let's do that on your own. Just pray for Tiffany that she would have just a to be filled with the Spirit as she serves there. Amen. Well, good morning and welcome. Those of you who are watching on YouTube, we're glad to have you be a part of this service. And it's just great for all of us to be here. We have some, oh, by the way, I didn't come with a joke like Tiffany would have, surely. Maybe another time. But anyway, we have some announcements to make. And if you'll just throw those announcements on the slide, there we go. So we have men's breakfast coming up this coming Saturday. There it is. Second Saturday of each month at 8 o'clock. It's a great time. We have a wonderful time. And Abby always fixes us an exceptional breakfast, better than you can get at Denny's or let's see. Yesterday I ate breakfast with a friend at in Sumner.
The buttered biscuit.
Oh, that is some good eating. But Abby's is even better.
Yes.
All right. So men's breakfast, and we also have Always in Stitches. And November 22nd from 10:30 to noon. And come and catch up. Bring your items, whatever you're going to be working on, and share and so forth. Always in Stitches, okay? And the next one is we have a ministry meeting coming up. And that is November 19th, I think? 21st? Okay, and it's between the first and second services in the social hall. It'll be our quarterly meeting. And if you can tell who that is, who is it?
George.
George is hiding in the Christmas tree. He's still there. No, there he is. I thought he was still there. But anyway, the Saturday following Thanksgiving, we have Hanging of the Trees, and it's a great annual event that we have here at First Baptist. So let's go ahead and begin our worship time.
Thank you. Our first song this morning is entitled "The Only Name," and it may be new to you, but I'm thinking you'll like the song. It has some fun places in it, and feel free to clap whenever the Spirit moves you, or moves you. Philippians 2:8-10 says that Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. As a result, God highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name. So at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. As believers in Jesus, we look forward to the day that's beyond time when we stand blameless before God because of what Jesus has done for us. He's given us authority in his name. He's given us healing, redemption in his name. Our identity is wrapped up in the name of Jesus. So as children of God, we are living for the glory of the Son of the living God. Jesus is the only name that matters. Stand as we sing, "The Only Name."
Yours will be the only name that matters to me. The only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. Yours will be the friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name that saved me. Mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. Yours will be the only name that matters to me, the only one whose favor I see, the only name that matters to me. And yours is the name saved me, mercy and grace, the power that forgave me, and your love is all I've ever needed. wake up in the land of glory. With the saints I will tell my story. There will be one name that I proclaim. La 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 la.
Morning. I know, you're all surprised to see me up here when I belong in the back. My name's Andrew. Today I'm the pastor's assistant. So let's go ahead and start by reading our meditation verse today. So this comes from Mark 10. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Let's go ahead and pray for our prayer request today. Dear Lord, thank you for letting us gather here together to worship you, your holy name. Thank you for everything that you give to us. And even though you've given us so much, we know that we can always ask for more. Please be with John Hopper as his knee has gotten worse and he'll likely need surgery. We pray for Debbie Baker's daughter, Gina, and she needs just comfort and stability for her mental and physical well-being. We know that little Ray has been called home to you. We pray that you'll be with the family during this time, granting them comfort. Please give healing to Nancy Hall as she continues to recover from surgery on a broken shoulder. I guess we'll close by saying we pray for this country, for this church, and this service. Please guide us all in the way that you know that we should go. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now let's keep worshiping.
Thank you, Andrew. The Gospels repeatedly declare that Jesus is the Messiah, the one chosen by God and anointed by him to save his people from their sins. Today, Jesus is still the Messiah. He's God's chosen, anointed one who came to deliver us from sin and Satan. When we use that name, we're truly saying that he is the name above all names. He is the Christ, the Son of God, the chosen one, the Savior of the world. Let's stand and sing with the worship team, Jesus Messiah.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah.
And minds for communion today, reflect on Jesus and who he is. Yes, he is the Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. For these reasons and so many more, he is not simply someone to be praised. He is the hope for sinners, a hope that is founded in his great sacrifice, for he was slain that we might live. In Romans 5:8, it says, God demonstrates his own love for us in this way. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Join with me as we sing, There is a Redeemer.
There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son.
So nice to see you all this morning. I've got my worthy assistants here, and if you'd like to prepare your hearts for the elements we're about to receive, then we will get started with our key verse today. It's on your outline. You guys don't have it. Sean, don't worry about it. I will quote it from memory because I was taught the scriptures, weaned on scripture, as it were. I remember those days as if they were yesterday, learning God's word. Our verse is Mark 10:45, where Jesus says to the disciples, "The Son of Man, even the Son of Man, did not come to be served, but to serve." What a countercultural statement that was and is. Because the model for today's successful person is you find yourself in a position where you are served. And maybe you serve, but number one has to be you get served. Everybody wants to be served. And Jesus says, no, that's not the way it is. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve. And this model that he had for the disciples was actually threefold. First and foremost, he served God. Even at the end, not my will, but thine be done. Three times he said that he served God. Secondly, he served the disciples and by extension, the church. Greater love hath no one than to give his life for a friend. The ultimate expression of his service to them was giving his life. But then the third dimension is the multitudes. Jesus spent a great deal of time reaching out to the multitudes. Sometimes he healed, sometimes he cast out demons, but for the most part, he was preaching a message that was fundamentally countercultural. And so that's our message. Our service begins with God. We love because he first loved us, is what the Apostle John said. We can only love because he first loved us. And if we don't have that dimension, then our expression of love isn't the same. It's a lesser love. It's a lower love. Secondly, each other. We serve each other. We love each other. The one another's are throughout the New Testament. All these one another's, all of these ways that we relate to each other. And then the third dimension, again, is beyond our family of faith, into the outside world. We love them. We love the stranger, the alien, the foreigner. This is our mandate, to serve in three dimensions. So I leave that thought with you, just using what we're dealing with here, a key verse, to try to amplify it as we receive these elements, because the very tradition that we're talking about here illustrates that. The grace of God begins with him and is extended to us. And these elements symbolize that as they go out. But then we're not supposed to keep it to ourselves. We then extend into the community. On Christmas Eve, we will show that same illustration with the light. The candle that is Christ will go to the church and then from the church out to the world, the light of the world. So I just wanted to kind of inspire you with that, a very poignant verse for us to think about as we await the elements. And with that, I'm going to call on Allie to return thanks for the bread.
Good morning. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we look at the bread. We see your suffering. We see the bruising, the stripes, and the piercing. Yet the piercing of your body is nothing in comparison to the piercing of your heart. You made the ultimate sacrifice so that we could have everything we need to be right with you. Thank you for the gift of salvation, a gift we could not possibly repay, but at the same time, a gift we can share with each other and with others. May we do so with the same selfless love that you have taught us, and in that way, bring honor and glory to you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
So we read that on the night that he was betrayed, as they gathered there in the upper room for what would be the Last Supper that they would share together, he took bread and in a moment established this tradition that we celebrate this morning. He took it, he broke it, he distributed it among the disciples, and he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And John will return thanks for the cup.
Lord, as we drink this wine, we are reminded that you came to give us life in abundance. Your sacrifice brought forgiveness of sin and made possible a relationship with the Father. You are the way, the truth, and the life. Because of the love you demonstrated for us, we can now respond in kind. Just as the wine has been poured out for us, it is a reminder to us that the love of you poured out for us on the cross is for us to draw upon. As we grow in our walk with you, as we face life's challenges with you, as we serve you, and as we share you with others, thank you for the gift of life. Life in abundance, life eternal. Amen.
Amen. In the same way, it says he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And now if you'd like to stand with us, we will say the Lord's Prayer. You can be an example if you want. Stay up here and lead the folks in the Lord's Prayer. Here we go. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Okay. I miss Tiffany. Do I have enough juice going out there? Yes. Kirk to Scott, engineering, I need more power. No, Scotty, no, I'm giving her everything she's got. Are we okay? You can hear our, good. A couple things on my brain. You notice the configuration is a little different. We are taking steps to go to one service, which will happen, I think the first trial Sunday will be December the 12th. And so changes are being made. In the event that there is a need for overflow, we are preparing another place for that to happen. Maybe it'll be used on Christmas Eve, who knows? But right now we're testing the simulcast system. So that's exciting that we have the technology to be able to do this. The exactly the same moment that people upstream on YouTube are getting it, it's also being beamed to the TVs and potentially more than one. So we could do it in the cafe, we could do it in the annex. So we're excited about that technology and grateful to Russ Henry for figuring out how to do that, along with this worthy assistant, Andrew. Thank you, Andrew. Guys in the back are awesome. I'm really, really proud of them. In other news, this week we did something pretty remarkable for a church our size. We reached out to the community first on Sunday with a trunk or treat event that probably had a couple hundred, 250, something like that. Jeff said he gave out 230 or 40 paper cups, the plastic cups of popcorn. So that's the only metric that we really have. Maybe some people took two, maybe some people didn't take any, but those are roughly the numbers. But that was a lot of people on our campus. If you saw the slides going by, you saw we had a lot of booths, a lot of activity, just a great opportunity to invite the community to be here and celebrate Halloween, redeem it, as it were, together. And then just Friday and Saturday, we had the blood drive here. So as they left last night, I asked them how many donations were made. In the 2 days, it was 49 pints, quarts, gallons, what do they take? I think it's pints. Yeah, so all of that is very helpful. It's nice that we could serve the community. We're talking about giving, and serving and giving go hand in hand, as you'll see. So that was a good exemplar. And for a church our size, to be able to sort of put ourselves on the map in that way, I think bodes well for our future. We want to reach out to the community. It is our mission. And so we've been serving them in that way. With that, let's go to the Lord before we begin the message. Pray with me, please. Lord, we're thankful to be in your house today, celebrating you, celebrating our relationship with you, and reaffirming what that means in our lives. How can we serve you better? How can we serve each other better? How can we serve the world better? So God, give us, as we talk about giving, the idea of giving back to you, God, help us to see that as a service to you that we do willingly because of the way you served us. For Christ's sake, amen. So the journey continues. For 7 weeks now, we have been talking about the challenges that we face as we make progress along this road that we call life, such as it is. So far, we've talked about making big decisions. That was week one. Talked about dealing with temptation, about handling hard times, living with loneliness, surviving stress, and beating the blues. That was last week's message. Now, this week we are going on offense, as it were, by introducing the first of two proactive themes, which will bring the series to a close next week. So, theme one today, theme two next week. Today, instead of talking about how to respond to life's negative challenges, we're going to talk about reaching some of life's positive goals. Goals that God tells us in his word should we should proactively pursue. You can avoid the negative, but you also need to pursue the positive. So today we're talking about a positive. With that preamble, today's theme is giving back to God. Giving back to God. That's right, we're talking about giving this morning, and if ever there was a more stereotyped sermon, I don't know what it is. Even though I only hit this topic maybe once a year, or you be the judge, if that, some of you here, some of you online will still go away thinking, yep, just as I suspected, all they want is my money. And like all stereotypes, that one is both unfair and untrue, actually. Because the truth is God will never be satisfied if all you give him is money. Because he is not looking for 10% of your income. He is looking for 100% of your life. Can you handle that? The truth is, everything that we have and all that we have achieved in this life are a gift from God, a gift that we will one day return to Him, dust to dust and ashes to ashes. He will get it all back sooner or later. In the meantime, He simply wants us to acknowledge a debt of gratitude that we all owe Him for what He has done for us, for what He has given to us. And however we choose to express that gratitude, whether in terms of our time or our talents or our treasure, God will accept what we give. He will make use of it, and He will give it back to us with interest that compounds from now to eternity. That's the fact. That's the truth. The trouble is, most people don't realize that giving is a 100% proposition. Very few people understand that out there. And so they place strict limits on what they will give to God. And then, unfortunately, they're a little disappointed when their ROI, their return on investment, isn't greater than it is. If P, then Q. It really is a simple equation. Jesus understood that the greatest return comes from the greatest investment. Any investors out there? Right, you've got to risk in order to see the reward. And the more you risk, the greater the reward potential. And so Jesus gave everything that He had to the Father. He gave it back to the Father, a gift that purchased eternal salvation for you and me and for the entire world. The entire world can be saved by that grace that Jesus gave by giving His life. Now that was a return on investment. And there's never been a greater one. And it didn't come by being stingy with God. It came through a life of service for others. As He said to His disciples, even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give His life as a ransom for many. In other words, the very reason that He entered history in the first place was not what He could get, but rather what He could give. And that sets Him apart from the rest of humanity. The point is, we don't fully realize what it means to give back to God, not as He did. Because instead of reciprocating God's gift to us by giving Him 100%, as Jesus did, we would rather negotiate a smaller percentage, if you don't mind. A smaller percentage of our life, thank you very much. Maybe just 10% of our income, which a lot of us regard as a very lofty goal, right? The best example of this negotiating that I found comes from that great theologian Burt Reynolds, of all people, in an offbeat movie that he did with Dom DeLuise called The End. Maybe you remember it. It's been a while. It was a little bit offbeat. But to give you a little bit of the backstory, it's about a middle-aged real estate broker going through midlife crisis. His name is Sonny, and he's been given 6 months to live. He decides to skip all the pain and to take his way out the easy way. So he's going to commit suicide. And Dom's going to help him with that. Problem is, he can't pull it off. I mean, these two numbskulls, they just can't seem to get it together. And that is sort of the comic element of the whole movie. After several failed suicide attempts, no thanks to the help of his inept sidekick, he finally comes up with what he thinks is a foolproof method. But it, too, will fail, as you'll see in the clip. But it comes close enough to prompt some very serious negotiations with God, which we do in times of stress. Let's see the clip.
I can never make it. Help me, Lord. Please. I promise not to try and kill myself anymore. Save me, and I swear I'll be a better father. I'll be a better man. I'll be a better everything. All I ask is, make me a better swimmer. Oh, God. I can't do this to Julie. We can't do this to Julie. God, let me live, and I promise to obey every one of the Ten Commandments. I shall not kill. I shall not commit adultery. I shall not. I'll learn the Ten Commandments, and then I'll obey every one of them.
Bleep.
Just get me back to the beach. I'll be honest in business. I promise not to sell lakeside lots unless there's a lake around. I want to see another sunrise. I want to see another sunset. It was a mistake, God. I never really wanted to kill myself. I just wanted to get your attention. Help me make it. I'll give you 50% of everything I make. 50%, God. I want to point out that nobody gives 50%. I'm talking gross, God. I think I'm going to make it. You won't regret this, Lord. I'll obey every commandment. I'll see my parents more often. No more cheating in business. Once I get rid of those 9 acres in the desert. And I'm going to start donating that 10% right away. I know I said 50%, Lord. But 10% to start. If you don't want your 10%, then don't take it. I know it was you that saved me, but it was also you that made me sick.
All right. According to psychologists, negotiating with God is one of the most common ways that people deal with loss. That little chart up there is kind of humorous, but those 5 key words, denial, anger, bargaining, depression, and acceptance, is oftentimes the order in which people go through these very significant changes. Could be end of life, it could be the loss of a loved one, whatever form of grief. Those stages are often a part of that picture. So we majored on bargaining, but you could hear a little anger there. You could hear some other notes coming in. And my question to you, because this is intended for us to sort of be able to relate to, even though it's humorous, have you ever done that? Have you ever negotiated with God? Oh, Lord, you've got to help me out of this financial hole I'm in. Please, just let me win the lottery. Do that, and I'll gladly give you the 10%. I'll even make it 20. But that's where I draw the line, Lord. That's my final offer, 20%. Take it or leave it. What Sonny failed to realize is that giving cannot be negotiated. Giving to God, at least, cannot be negotiated. A gift with strings attached is no gift at all, right? So it can't be negotiated. And that's why Jesus said, let your yes be a yes and your no, no. Anything more comes from the evil one. Pretty harsh words, but true nonetheless. The devil is in the details. And as soon as you start messing around in there, you know what they say, figures don't lie, but liars figure. Because once you start calculating how you will benefit from your giving, then the whole spirit of giving is absent from that equation. So in order to be genuine givers, we need to give the way Jesus gave, and with the same selfless motivation. This morning, with his example as our guide, I want to share 5 reasons to be a giver in the biblical sense. If you're following along on your outline, the first reason to give is that giving reflects God's character. The C word there is character. Giving reflects God's character. Jesus said it is more blessed to give than it is to receive. And again, he would know. Not only did he give his life, he himself was a gift to humanity, given by the Father for the benefit of the whole world. As the Apostle John said, for God so loved the world that he gave. He gave his only Son. As James said, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights. The point is, the Father is a giver. The Son is a giver. And we have been created in God's image to be givers also. We should be givers because giving reflects God's character. That's point one. The second reason to be a giver is that giving breaks the spell of materialism. It breaks the spell of materialism. If you don't believe that materialism casts a literal spell on people, on entire nations, how do you explain the current national debt, which is sitting right now at $29 trillion, when just 14 years ago in 2008, it was $6.4 trillion? I mean, we are on a logarithmic, a geometric progression to oblivion with our national finances. We're on a spending spree as a nation, no end in sight. This isn't going to end well, folks. And if you look at the next slide there, this gap, this ever-expanding gap, as you can see, the line down the middle is the current time, and the projections go even further, and those are not steep enough, given what Congress is talking about right now. That gap is not widening fast enough. And the thing is, if you were as irresponsible with your spending as our nation is, your creditors would have garnished your wages a long time ago. I mean, you would be hurting, and the system would deal with you. But what system deals with the system? And our system is out of control. The problem, plain and simple, is materialism, this spell that I'm talking about. And Jesus' solution to the problem was simple. As he explained in the Sermon on the Mount, you cannot serve God and mammon. Choose. We're supposed to be a Christian nation. In God we trust, yada, yada. Are we? There is an actual demon whose goal it is to addict people to wealth. His name is Mammon. Mammon. As the Apostle Paul further explained, people who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. So who is he talking about here? Oh, I don't know. Could be college grads who basically mortgage their future. A lot of times they're $200,000 in debt before they even graduate, much less have a job to pay it back. Or consumers who max out their credit cards, letting them revolve every month at 18% APR. Mindless. So many people do that. Or the millions of homeowners that lose their homes every down cycle in the real estate market. They overextend, the market turns a little earlier than they'd hoped, and now they're underwater, and foreclosure ensues. The bottom line is Americans in particular, you could say this about the world as well, but Americans in particular are under this spell of materialism. And folks, the good news is that generosity, the opposite, becoming a giver instead of a taker, is how you break that spell. It is an antidote to the poison of materialism. Which brings us to a third reason to be a giver. There on your outline, number three, giving is an eternal investment. Keyword, eternal. And that is precisely why Jesus said, quote, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal." It's an eternal investment, was his point. We have a choice. We can invest in worldly things that we know won't last. Nothing in this world does. Or we can invest in spiritual things that will yield eternal dividends, which makes more sense. This choice became crystal clear for me when I was teaching high school back in the day. That was my Jonah phase. Between ministry and ministry, there was high school. I was kind of running at that time. But there was this retirement seminar given for teachers on campus after school. It was put on by a local investment firm. And so as I got to the end there, they asked if I anybody else wanted to meet with a professional advisor. And so I agreed. I signed up. a couple of weeks later, you know, Linda and I were there. We showed up for our appointment. We met with the advisor thinking that he was going to set up for us some kind of a wise retirement plan and maybe a college fund for our two boys. Well, he asked a bunch of questions, as I knew he would. I came prepared for that. He plugged in all the numbers, yeah, and then out came his recommendation. He wanted to take the equity in our home and invest it in a portfolio of stocks. That was his big plan. By his estimate, that would increase our income by at least 10%. Well, that number kind of hit me as a little funny. And so my immediate response was that it seemed like a pretty big risk to take just to offset the 10% that I was already giving to the church. And when I said that, you should have seen his expression change. Priceless. You would have thought I'd grown a third eye right in front of him. He hadn't even asked, you see, about our contributions. That side of it wasn't even part of his radar. And it was painfully obvious that he thought that we were just about the stupidest couple that ever walked into his office. And so I realized then and there, pretty immediately, that we were wasting our time, that this was a big mistake. Because his only desire was to open an account, for us to open an account with him, with them, so that he could begin making his commission. That was it. It was so obvious. As a worldly advisor, you see, he was unable to appreciate the spiritual truth that we invest for eternity. That's the only investment that lasts. That's number three. A fourth reason to be a giver is that it reflects the attitude of our heart. Giving reflects the attitude of your heart. At the end of the passage that we just read, Jesus said, "Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." That investment advisor that I just introduced to you couldn't help us. And the reason he couldn't help us is because his treasure, his heart, was bound to the things of this world. And because he was under the spell of materialism, even Christians sometimes find it hard to be givers. He saw no practical value in giving hard-earned money away. To him, that was absurd. And the sad truth is that spell that we're talking about has become so powerful in our culture that even Christians find it hard to be givers, even Christians, because we live in a world that's going in the opposite direction. Paul's solution to the problem is found in 2 Corinthians 9. He said, "Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver." In other words, whatever we decide to give at a point in time, it should not exceed our ability to give cheerfully. It should not go beyond what we can give cheerfully. That's a good kind of a limit, a good barometer of how do I give. When I'm not giving cheerfully, I should stop. And I know that's counter to what you think I should say, what you're expecting me to say, give till it hurts, dig deep. No, if you can't give cheerfully, do not do so. That's the scriptural principle. Paul clearly understood that giving reflects the attitude of our heart, and that attitude needs to be right. And that brings me to a fifth and final reason to be a giver. We are stewards of what God has given us. This is the bottom line. We are stewards of what God has given to us. If you remember the parable of the talents, a pretty key parable in the New Testament, in the Gospels, the whole point that Jesus is making in this story is that we have a responsibility as stewards of the resources that God has entrusted to us. Whether they're great or small, we are stewards of those resources. As he explained, God's kingdom is like a landowner. This is the way he begins. It's like a landowner who gave to three of his servants one, two, and five talents, respectively, so that they could manage his wealth for him while he was away. He's delegated this task. You're going to manage my wealth. I'm giving you this much, you this much, one, two, and five talents. Well, upon his return, he learned that two of his servants had actually doubled his investment, doubled his money. And so he said to both of them, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful in a few things. I will put you in charge of many." Come and share in your master's happiness. At that point, the servant to whom the smallest amount was given said, quote, Master, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. What was Jesus' response when he heard this man's lame excuse for not investing the talent that he'd asked him to put to work? The master said, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. And then he said, take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10. Ouch. The lesson is this. Once you understand your true identity as a steward of God's resources, everything that he's given to you, everything he's entrusted you with in your life, all that reality, that everything you have is in fact his, it was, and it will be his, that's the reality. The question isn't whether you should invest yourself in God's work. The question is how you will invest yourself in God's work. I mean, it's got to make sense, right? How is the question. How will you give your time, your talents, your treasure back to the one who gave it to you and will exact it all back again at the end? I mean, that isn't the ultimate end. Eternity begins, but we are going to be held accountable. I'll close this morning by sharing three implications of the role that we have as stewards, implications that are so profound, so diametrically opposed to what the world considers wisdom, that some people simply can't accept the implications I'm about to lay on you. They just can't. So what are these implications? Well, the first one I've already alluded to. Number one, what you have isn't actually yours. That's the first implication. Pretty hard to get your mind, if you're into this world, if you're into possessions, if you're under the spell of materialism, then this doesn't make any sense whatsoever. What you have isn't actually yours. King David understood this principle. So before, in his old age, before he turned the kingdom over to Solomon, his son, he launched a capital campaign. It was something he'd been planning to do, but God told him, no, this won't happen under your watch. It will happen under Solomon's. But he launched it. He got the thing rolling, a capital campaign to fully fund the construction of the temple. This is a theme that's played out throughout Israel's history. You know, Nehemiah rebuilt the walls and so on. There's a big issue with the temple in the Old Testament because it's the place where God invests his presence, or did. And so he's going to do this, and he's figured it all out. He's got the plans laid out, and so now he's launching a capital campaign to set his son up so that he can literally just build. So three things made the campaign that he launched a success. Three things. Number one, David set the tone by generously giving to the cause from his own treasury. I mean, kings ruled absolutely. So what was in the treasury was his. It was in his control. It was his to do with as he pleased. There were no watchdogs, any kind of administration or bureaucracy keeping him strictly in line. No, it was up to him. Secondly, the leading families in Jerusalem followed his example. The leading families, the noble families, followed his example. And thirdly, the people of Israel, it says, quote, freely and wholeheartedly gave to the work. Freely and wholeheartedly. Remember the attitude. As a result, the Temple of Solomon became the greatest temple ever built in Jerusalem, either before or since. That golden age, Israel's golden age, was focused in Jerusalem on this grand temple that Solomon built. But at the end of the campaign, David's public prayer reflected his understanding of his role as a steward. He said this to God, "Who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand." Let me hit that one again. Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand. The point is, it's much easier to be a giver when you realize that as a steward, everything you have already belongs to God. It came from Him, it will return to Him. That's the first implication. The second implication of being a steward is the knowledge that you will be held accountable. I mentioned this before, I hit it a little harder right now. In the parable of the talents that we looked at, the servant who was given the least, who just had the one talent to invest, he was still held accountable to the highest degree, right? Accountable for failing to produce any return on that investment. And as a result, his only talent was taken away and given to another. This doesn't play very well in an entitlement society like ours, where there's all this free stuff that just comes down, and there's this patronage and so on that comes from this class down to this class. Go on for days on that, but the middle class is disappearing, and that is a very sad thing, to have an elite class simply by their bounty, you know, deciding how all these funds are going to be spread, and everyone has to have their hand out and do exactly what they say. Yes, I'll take the vaccine, please. May I have another? Okay, I'm done. Paul said this, each one of us will give an account of himself to God. We're going to be held accountable for how we invested the resources that he entrusted us with. We are responsible for those resources as a steward. And even though it's a negative reinforcement, this idea of accountability, it is balanced by a third implication. So on the one hand, you have the stick. Now let's talk about the carrot. Implication number three is the fact that good stewards are always rewarded. There is a reward. And we saw that in the parable. The two servants who doubled their master's investment received, in fact, a threefold reward. Threefold, how does that work? Well, first they earned the praise of their master, which in a feudal system is pretty important. Second, they were given a greater role in their master's business. And third, they shared in his happiness, in his blessing. In other words, the blessing came back to them. As Jesus reminded his disciples, your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Giving isn't something that, you know, we parade up to front and everyone sees, you know, as we drop the dollars into the plate and let's do it slowly and let's just milk this moment for everything. No, it should be done in secret because the only person we're trying to impress is our Heavenly Father. We want Him to know that we get it, that everything that we have was His, is His, and always will be His. God's reward, then, is yet another reason for us to be good stewards of the resources that He has blessed us with. I'll make one more connection before I close. I don't know whether you've thought about it or not, but this Thursday, Americans will continue a tradition that began a century ago at the end of World War I. It's hard to imagine a more compelling example of giving than what Lincoln referred to as the last full measure of devotion. That's a gift. And that gift has been given many times on behalf of this nation. Jesus said, greater love hath no man than this, to lay down his life for his friends. And Jesus could say that because he did more, so much more than just die for his country. He died to save the entire world, and he died for all eternity. That was a gift that goes on giving for the rest of eternity. And so his example, more than any other, shows us what it means to give back to God, to be a giver. Let's pray. What this message shows, God, what your scripture teaching is that the learning curve is steep. Because of the way of the world, this is so countercultural, it's hard for us to accept. And yet you accept us where we are. And all you do as our Heavenly Father, Lord, is you raise the bar. When we achieve thus and such, you say, okay, well, now that you've done that, let's do a little bit more. And you do that because you're our Heavenly Father and you love us and you've given us so much. And so, God, we do not take for granted the responsibility and the privilege of being a steward of the Lord. Thank you for that. Help us, God. Give us wisdom so that we might please you and earn that well done, good and faithful servant. In Jesus' name, amen.
I've never been very good at the whole response thing, so but before and during the sermon, I have to write down my thoughts, so hopefully this comes out more or less coherent. So giving is always a bit of a touchy subject. We think that because we put in the effort to get what we've rightfully earned, that we should keep it. We, me. Anything that gets between us and what we've rightfully earned is suspect. But obviously this is the wrong perspective to have. We need to think about this from God's perspective. Our lives on this earth are but a vapor, and the money we earn here even more so. But as the pastor said, by giving we make an eternal investment in our treasures in heaven. We tend to be touchy about money, but far less so about the other ways to give, our talents and our time. These two ways can be just as effective, if not more so, than money. Being a pastor's kid, the time and talents part always seemed like a foregone conclusion for me. I was brought along to all the church events, and since I'm there, I might as well help out, or else. But when I became an adult and started tithing myself, I found that it felt different than when I gave my time and my talents, perhaps because doing so was wholly my choice this time. The feeling is important. Giving should feel like it costs you something, but it shouldn't be so painful that you become resentful. Like it says in 2 Corinthians, each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give. There has to be a balance between these things. Let's pray for the offering. Dear Lord, please take what we give and use it for the kingdom. Please guide us and keep us in your will. Help us remember this message and be good stewards for you. Amen.
Amen. Psalm 19:1 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, the skies proclaim the work of his hands." Please stand as the worship team comes forward and we're going to sing "All Heaven Declares."
Thanks, guys, for leading us in an act of giving, a sacrifice of praise. And it's great to have my son, you know, ministering with me, that, you know, losing Tiffany, but, you know, gaining the son. So can we give him a round of applause? This is the beginning of a tradition that we want to establish, where once a month we have somebody from y'all, our young adult leaders, lead. So we're going to try to include them every month in that. So thanks, Andrew. Thanks, guys, for stepping up to that. We're going to have a time of fellowship now, so let's kick that off with the blessing. Would you bow with me? May God bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. Amen. See you in the social hall.